And our next speaker is going to entertain us with his story. And I'm sure you want to hear Rainier talk about his life and his very interesting life and his writings.
Yes.
Magandang araw sa inyong lahat. It's wonderful. It's wonderful to see smiling faces, and I'm really delighted that some people who haven't been here for quite some time showed up. And I got up very early this morning. The first beautiful thing I saw was the moon sickle. The second I saw an equally wonderful sunrise. And then a fantastic trip to Utrecht, which is always worth a trip. And then I was a little bit sad because I was told to deliver the talk in English, which is not my native tongue. All those people who know me quite well know that I find manuscripts and papers quite despicable. You have to work hard to improve your rhetoric and to speak freely without manuscripts. But since I was given a time, strict time, 30 minutes, it was a matter of bargaining to be succeed over Coney as the master of ceremony, it's quite hard. But I had a very charming fellow on my side. His name is, I call him sometimes Maria, Jose Maria, Sison, Joma, and whatever. Joma intervened and said, give that damn guy, as long as he talks meaty and witty. Then I had to sign an agreement before the ceasefire that I stick to the time, and unfortunately, to do so, I prepared a manuscript. And, well, to round up the introduction, what is the best way to greet you all? I think one of my favorite authors is Samuel Langhorne Clemens. Most of you know him under his pen name, Mark Twain. And Mark Twain is an interesting figure. He's not an outstanding author only, but what is obliterated in his biography, you should think about it. I think many people even don't know. From the year 1901 until the death in April 1910, Mark Twain was the vice president of the Anti-Imperialist League of the United States of America. Whenever people talk about Mark Twain, they never ever dare to mention this part of his life. And it was a significant part. I mean, one decade is quite a span of time. And he also said once, give every day the chance to be the finest and best one of your life. This is always a challenge, and I think this is the very last Saturday we have within this week. So let's try to make this really a very, very good day till midnight. And now I think I have to stick to my manuscript. Those speaking before and after me today will be talking about macro-political issues and revolutionary projects, both in the Philippines and in the international context. However, I was asked by the organizers of this afternoon's event to focus on less spectacular matters, such as how I first came upon the Philippines, my first acquaintance with and perception of the country and its people, and what ultimately led me to remain committed to the international solidarity with the Philippines for half a century. This is a premiere. Never before has this been the subject of a speech or input I have given? And since in just a few hours, Joma and I, we make up 150 years only until midnight. Then I will be turning 70, and he soon will be turning 81. And I have decided to share some personal insights and information with you in 7 well-measured steps and points. One step or point per decade of my life. So I offer you 7 short points. I could add many more. I was so delighted to given this task. I had to do some brainstorming, and so many vivid memories came back to my mind. And among them, people would not believe it, when I was at the age of 20 and the first time in the Philippines, very often I walked on foot from Project 6, which is near UP Diliman, down to the Sherdot building, which housed the Manila Bulletin then, opposite of Pamantasan, on foot. I was thinking about it, I think not even 1/10 of that distance would I ever manage today. I come to my first point. I have always considered it a great privilege to have spent a wonderful childhood in the sheltered environment of an intact family. I believe this is something I shared with my co-author, along with the fact that we were both ex-altar boys or ex-sacristans. So at night time, this guy never sleeps, sometimes I do the same, and then we have some exchange of emails, so we always call each other ex-sacristan Kabugao, ex-sacristan Münster. And sometimes, if I'm given the privilege, I call him Maria, and he calls me the son of a gun. And then, after all, I have to take revenge, because, you know, my promise was given back in Utrecht on December 29 last year. I promised to very close friends of mine I will have a sabbatical. And then came an ominous email dated on January 23, Anno Domini 2019, and then Maria said, would you like to make another book, a sequel to the other one 30 years ago? Anyway, we had to match Non Limit Tangeren, El Philippus Terismo, given the times of modernization and globalization. So I was so... Anyway, I said yes, and that's why we are sitting here together. Otherwise, you could not listen to that story at all. And so, ex-sacristans, he in Kabugao, in the north of the Philippines, and I in the plains of the Westphalian Münsterland, not so far from here, in the northwest corner of what I refer to as Teutonia, and which, of course, means Germany. While Joma was still pondering the option of becoming a bishop until the age of around 18 and 19, I had already turned my back on the Roman Catholic Church, the so-called One True Church, some years earlier. This was possible because in Germany at the age of 14, young people are free to decide on their religious affiliation. The factors that led me to take this step were the insights acquired from intensive reading into the long tradition of obscurantism, persecution, and contempt for mankind in the form of the Inquisition, along with my observation of the omnipresent bigotry of churchgoers who played the devout Christian on Sundays only to behave rather shabbily in various ways for the rest of the week. Above all, as Karl Marx has succinctly pointed out in his introduction to the Critique of Hegel's Philosophy of Right, I quote him, "The criticism of religion is the prerequisite of all criticism. Criticism has plucked the imaginary flowers on the chain, not in order that man should continue to bear that chain without fantasy or consolation, but so that he shall throw off the chain and pluck the living flower. Thus, the criticism of heaven turns into the criticism of earth, the criticism of religion into the criticism of law, and the criticism of theology into the criticism of politics." It was written, quote, end, back in 1843-1844. In my younger years, hitchhiking trips also taught me to see things from different wider perspectives, in the sense of the East Asian proverb that even Mao Zedong sometimes quoted. Speaking on perspectives and small thinking, Mao once remarked, quote, "We think too small, like the frog at the bottom of the well. He thinks the sky is only as big as the top of the well." If he surfaced, he would have an entirely different view, quote end. Indeed, it is a rather tedious task to struggle your way all up to the top. But once you finally, you succeeded in doing so, it is then that the full abundance of undreamt of perspective is revealed. The second episode of seven, I became socialized and politicized during the so-called Movement of 68, which was a worldwide phenomenon with widely varying aspects. In West Germany, it was about coming to terms with and confronting the period of Nazi terror, about getting rid of the hierarchical professor-dominated universities, student protests against the emergency laws that granted the cabinet to pass laws without the approval of parliament in times of emergency, about women's emancipation, and last but not least, the US-American aggression against the peoples of Vietnam, Laos, and Cambodia. A wide range of literature helped to underpin my personal criticism of all the above. This included texts from the Frankfurt School of Critical Theory. Above all, people are familiar with the names Theodor Adorno, Max Horkheimer, Jürgen Habermas, and Herbert Marcuse, as well as the writings of Karl Marx, Lenin, and Mao Zedong. Particularly significant was Horkheimer's and Adorno's opus Dialectic of Enlightenment, which was written at the end of the war back in 1944. The first edition appeared nearby in Amsterdam at Querido Publication, and I can highly recommend to read that book again. It is very, very up-to-date and very modern. Their work sees the self-destruction of Western reason culminating in the barbarism of the Nazis as grounded in a historical and fateful dialectic between the domination of external nature and society. They trace enlightenment, which split these spheres apart, back to its mythical roots. Enlightenment and myth, therefore, are not irreconcilable opposites, but dialectically mediated qualities of both real and intellectual life. Myth is already enlightenment, and enlightenment reverts to mythology. This paradox is the fundamental thesis of the book. The third point. The things I experienced and witnessed on my travels, such as a fight between lepers in the Ethiopian highlands for a piece of bread that travelers had thrown out of the bus, the works that I read, my innate rejection of hierarchy along with my personal perception of school as a means of indoctrination, all combined to sharpen a rebellious spirit in me as a young person who had in the meantime also lost both parents. This led, among other things, to my expulsion from school, the first case ever of a student being expelled or relegated from school in the city of Münster. To cope with this situation and comprehend the whys and hows, I sat down and disciplined myself to write my very first book, which bore the title Herrschaftsmechanismus an der Schule, am Beispiel einer Relegation. There are some people who are so smart in the English tongue, if they want to translate that, please. Herrschaftsmechanismus an der Schule. The rule of dominion, power. Ne? Of power and school. And then am Beispiel einer Relegation. and I had it all really well documented with all the legal cases that went to it. And then, I wasn't even 20 years old. I found a lot of satisfaction in traveling the world, in writing, and my work with a leftist publishing house as the editor for its internationalism series, in which, by the way, my German translation of legendary Amado Guerrero's Philippine Society and Revolution was published back in May 73. Philippine Society and Revolution served as an introductory text for everyone who, at the end of the 70s and early 80s, was at the heart of the West German-Philippine solidarity movement in form of the Aktionsgruppe Philippinen e.V. ACWI for short. And there's one person, Jörg, I would like you to stand up briefly. We worked together 40 years. Please. You are so tall, show all your greatness. Please do me that favor. I'm turning 70 tomorrow.
Just for you, my dear.
Thank you so much. Imagine 40 years we shared. There in between he was with the church. But he found his way back again. I come to my fourth point. After having undertaken research in Japan on the militant student movement, Zengakuren, during the Korean War and its aftermath, I decided to travel by boat via Taiwan and the Philippines to Hong Kong to fly back from there to Europe. The Year of the Dog, 1970, was in full swing when in autumn of that year I got off the boat of the Philippine President Lines in Manila Harbor. While I had originally planned to stay in the Philippines for a maximum of 3 weeks, I ended up staying there until the end of August 1971, a few days after the Plaza Miranda bombing on August 21 that year. I had the extraordinary privilege of being asked by many kind and warm-hearted people to stay with them and share their lives for a while. Among them was the family of the editor-in-chief of the well-known daily newspaper in Manila, who lived in Project 6 near the University of the Philippines in Diliman, Quezon City. This university was a hotbed of political and social unrest at the time. My close friendship with several local student activists, notably Antonio Tony Tagamolila and Leopoldo Babes Calixto, progressive intellectuals and left-wing journalists, including Antonio Tony Sumel, meant that I automatically became a direct witness of the first quarter storm back in 1970. It was politically turbulent time, during which I also traveled extensively throughout the islands. This period was a truly unique form of apprenticeship for me. Number five, four things in particular immediately struck me as quite astounding during my first encounter with the Philippines. Firstly, the open, relaxed manner combined with a good portion of self-irony in which political work took place within the very convivial left-wing groups that I became acquainted with. Secondly, the flood of abbreviations and acronyms that Pinoys consider are or should be just as familiar to foreigners as they are to themselves. Thirdly, the uncomplicated attitude of patriotism combined with a deep-seated desire to develop genuinely national or nationalist politics. Fourthly, the social and political commitment of well-known members of the lower ranks of the clergy, rooted in the concept of theology of struggle that even went beyond the Latin American liberation theology. All this taught me very important lessons. Where there is a divide separating wit and resistance, where there is no place for humor, where dogmatism reigns supreme and self-irony is taboo, then you need to be on your guard. The Philippine variant of the 68 movement was the combination of a number of specific internal and external factors that went back to the founding of the Republic of the Philippines on July 4, 1946. It was characteristic of the neo-colonial character of the state that its founding date coincided with that of the USA, the former colonial power. And as we know only too well, the ex-colonial masters succeeded in effortlessly shaping Philippine domestic policy into an extension of US foreign policy without any criticism from the ruling elites in Manila. As a former colony of the United States, the Philippines formed the natural center of strictly anti-communist ideologies in Southeast Asia during the Cold War era. It was in Manila that SEATO, the Southeast Asian counterpart to NATO, was founded in the mid-50s. And it was from the US military installation Subic Naval Base and Clark Airfield that B-52 bomber squadrons took off incessantly, carrying their deadly cargo, including toxic gases, Agent Orange, and napalm, to be released over Vietnam, Laos, and Cambodia. Nevertheless, for some unknown reasons, the Philippines and its role in the Vietnam War during the 60s and 70s remained a blind spot for the Western European left. The political processes taking place in that region and the struggles of students, transport workers, small farmers, and the critical intelligentsia were virtually unknown, even to internationalists, and they remained so quiet some time. Sorry. I give you also some breathing space. Wow, even I learned to love acronyms. Especially the late one is my favorite, Gringo. I'm not referring to a madman in the White House who wants to pressure Europe to believe that Russia is pressuring Europe and so on and so forth. But Gringo stands, is so beautiful, for government run and inspired NGO. That's a very, very special species. This, in fact, was not coined in those years later, but I think it's outstandingly charming. Again, government-run and inspired NGO. You think about that. And then you get to the zebronkies, neither zebra nor donkey. And finally, I mutated from being a fierce atheist to become a mellowed agnostic. After witnessing the social, political, and revolutionary commitment of members of the lower clergy, the former bishop of Bacolod, Antonio Fortich, with his feisty dedication to the marginalized and above all the Sakadas, made an unforgettable impression on me. Displayed on his expansive desk were a number of stuffed sparrows. According to the ever cautious and good-humored bishop, they had been killed in his stead in shotgun attacks. The good man liked to smoke cigars and pipes, remarking with a grin, "It's better to smoke on earth than to be grilled in heaven." He would also compare the actions, laws, and international treaties signed by the rulers in Manila to water lilies, all wonderful to look at, but without any anchoring. I come almost to a close. It's now point number 6. In February 1971, the short-lived Diliman commune, with its own radio station, Bandilang Pula, Red Flag, and the publication of the same name was established on the UP campus. Here too, The security forces attacked the students with extreme brutality. I could call them back and forth from Project 6, not inside. When you were stuck inside, you could not get outside then. For many of them, this was a turning point that finally led them to abandon their academic careers and sheltered homes in favor of life in the political underground or in the armed struggle within the ranks of the NPA. I think the book still that is incredible to read is Jose Lacaba, Days of Disquiet, Nights of Range. It's one of the most authoritative books on this subject. In the late summer of 71, back in Western Europe, I was brimming over with ideas, experiences, and zest for action. One of the factors that motivated me to become active in the Philippine solidarity work was the news that my incredibly warm-hearted friends and wonderful kasamas, Tony Tagamulila of the UP Diliman student publication, UP, the Philippine Collegian, and Babes Calixto of the College Editors Guild of the Philippines, had been killed in the political underground after Marcos' imposition of martial law in September 2. I checked it exactly. Tony Tagamulila, he was my age. He would have turned 70 as well next month. He was killed in a small town at the border of the provinces Aklan and Capiz. And Babes Calixto was about 5 years my senior, I think 1945. And he was killed in an encounter in Iloilo. And remarkably, it happened in 1972. Tony was killed on February 18, and Babes on February 20, so just 2 days apart. And we had a very, very close relationship. And to me, those were really, they were embodying the species of the finest Filipinos you can think of. Coming from the roots, committed to go back there, and found it despicable, the corruption and the irresponsibilities, the criminal irresponsibilities of the ruling elite. And it was really, I think, a very, very big loss, like many, many other people. Of course, you have your own experiences. But that struck me very deeply. If, like many others, they had had the choice of choosing an inscription for a proper tombstone, it would surely have borne these three lines: Makibaka huwag matakot, dare to struggle, dare to win, serve the people. In the meantime, other comrades managed to flee abroad, some of them to the Netherlands. It was at that time that I vowed to show my fallen comrades the respect and honor they deserved by committing myself to active involvement in the Philippine Solidarity Movement until my last breath. The last point, now number 7. I put this pledge into practice at the end of the 70s and beginning of the 80s through my involvement then with ACNI, Action Group Philippines. Shortly before the fall of Marcos, which turned out to be a mere reshuffling of power within the Manila elites, there were some 40 other Philippine solidarity groups in West Germany, Austria, and Switzerland. Linking information work of a high journalistic standard to the work of the solidarity movement helped to boost their campaigns on behalf of the numerous political prisoners. For a decade, 1990 until 2000, I worked closely with Filipino staff as executive director of a foundation dedicated to the interests of children in armed conflict in Mindanao, Basilan, and Jolo, Southeast Asia's oldest conflict region. This led, even then, to the silly accusation of recruiting youngsters for the NPA. Thomas Mann's dictum, anti-communism is the basic folly of our era, could once again be experienced at first hand. And it still holds good today in the form of omnipresent red tagging. What constituted the most tragic chapter in the history of the Philippine movement of 68 were the various purges that were carried out within the CPP-NPA in the 80s, costing the lives of numerous comrades after a series of military setbacks had given rise to paranoia and panic. This was, in my opinion, a fatal reversal of the doctrine that politics commands the gun, and the gun must be never command politics. Otherwise, you get entangled in sheer militarism. For 40 years now, my beloved, and then I had to sneak in, charming Filipino partner and wife, Marilu, and I have spent our days waking up in the morning to the news from the Philippines. But since these are usually rather unpleasant, I also spent time on the study of other countries in the region, and I've been involved in solidarity networks there too, notably on both Koreas. And we should once organize a workshop, what happened to the years 1986 in the Philippines and 1987 in South Korea. We will find remarkable results. At least, I must say, they are far, far ahead when it comes to democratic achievements, jailing CEOs, even ex-presidents. I mean, wouldn't it be a wonderful idea to see Mamutin Lupa and other prisons filled with all the trapos and ex-presidents? But in South Korea, it is reality. So it's amazing. I'm not joking here. And that was some sort of compensation. If you wake up always in the morning to some sad news, and sometimes it's nice to also get acquainted with good news. After all, we are human beings. As well as publishing regularly in the print media and for radio stations, writing, lecturing, and my teaching assignments at some universities have, in a certain sense, allowed me to achieve an ideal merging of professional occupation, vocation, and hobby. What does that all leave us with? The foremost task of the left is to acquire, by means of sophisticated liaison work, sufficient power to put an end to conditions of domination and to render impossible the domination of human beings over their fellow men and over nature. The book being launched today offers, among others, valuable guidelines in pursuing this path. And in this context, and without being able to yet foresee the implications of the rapidly growing existential environmental problems we are facing today, Rosa Luxemburg once spoke of the straight choice, socialism or barbarism. I end my remarks with a critique of someone who once rather pompously pretended to go down in Pinoy history as its first ever socialist president. The quotation will last less than 1 minute, and after that you are invited to guess the source. At this time already, thank you so much for your patience and your kind attention. Maraming, maraming salamat po. But now, you still have to listen. I quote, and you make a guess. And whoever, three people are not allowed to vote because they know that. Only three people, all the others. And whoever get that, we will share a very charming ecumenical peppermint tea. Quote Sat. I'm always 79 years old. You know that I did not write that, no? And in my lifetime, I have never heard any of the past presidents of the Philippines I can remember back to President Manuel Rojas, use the kind of gutter language President Duterte uses in public. Nor do I recall having read or heard of any other head of government who talked, much less bragged, about his penis. There was a speech. He talked 3 minutes and 29 seconds, to be precise, about the different sizes of his penis. For that matter, I have never read or heard about any head of government who has insulted men of the cloth or urged his soldiers to shoot women rebels in the vagina, or ask his policemen why they have not yet killed certain people. All these in public. So this must be material for the Guinness World Records. What is also for the Guinness World Records is that President Duterte, in spite of all this, enjoys the trust and satisfaction reportedly of almost 8 out of 10 Filipinos. So, if he is irrational, what does that make us? End of quote. Any idea? Any idea? I give you one clue. It's a lady. It's a lady. It's also a columnist. In this case, for PDI, Philippine Daily Inquirer. And the very first lady who chaired the National Economic and Development Authority office under Madame Aquino. So, you are all right. It's right. It's the column Get Real, Inexcusable, Unworthy, But What About Us? By Solita Colas Monsor, Philippine Daily Inquirer, April 13, the year 2019. There's a very last sentence in reference to Tony and Babes is the tradition I was talking about, and to follow their path and take up this tradition of fight and struggle. It's a beautiful saying. It's basically attributed to Gustav Mahler, but sometimes also to the French socialist Jean Jaurès. It says tradition is not the adoration of the ashes, but the passing on of the flame, or rather fire. So that's the end of my talk.
Thank you very much, Henry. And it was really a very interesting talk. So I'm glad. So I'm glad you had more than 30 minutes.